and we've been in this authentic series, looking at this authentic series. We've been looking at the book of Acts through this authentic series. And what we see in the book of Acts, and the reason we're calling it authentic, is because we see these authentic believers coming together, becoming the authentic church. They are real Christians. They're living out real lives, and they're being the real church. Day in and day out, they're just going about living their lives filled with the Holy Spirit, living as Jesus witnesses. You know, Jesus told them in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, that when the Spirit comes on you, you will receive power to be my witnesses. And so they were his witnesses wherever they went, even to the ends of the world, is what Jesus says. You will be my witnesses in Judea, Samaria, or Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the world, even to the ends of the world. And we see that in the book of Acts. They went everywhere. Now, of course, they didn't make it to the United States. I don't know if their ships could have made it that far. They didn't make it to North America. I didn't even know if they knew there was a North America. But they made it all around the parts of the world that they knew, all the civilized parts of the world. They became witnesses of Jesus, and they tell people all about Jesus. And like Jesus, they speak in power and with conviction, and they go out in love and compassion, and they care for the hurting and the needy, and they're catalysts for God's miracles. And so in that way, they experience the life of Jesus, but they even experience it in persecution, which we have seen in the outcome of building Christ-like, which we have seen is the outcome of building Christ-like character into our lives. Now, from what we saw last week, we realized, though, that this church wasn't perfect, right? Remember that? Hey, we have problems. and the church had problems. And they had problems because there were people in the church. And people have problems, right?
Amen.
Yeah, people have problems. I have problems. You have problems. And in some way, and usually they almost always come from some sort of selfishness or pride within us, which I could see could have easily happened in that very early church in the book of Acts when we looked at Acts chapter 6. Now, this week, we're going to see more problems, but they're not coming from the church. This week, we're going to end up seeing that what we saw from last week is kind of an introduction to an individual, and we're going to find out more about that person today. A man named Stephen. A man who had a good reputation. Have you ever met somebody with a good reputation? Somebody you've heard about that has a good reputation, and then you've had this chance to meet them, where their reputation preceded them. Maybe you've met someone whose reputation preceded them for not such good reasons. Have you ever met somebody like that? And I was like, hey, you know about this person, and then soon you meet them. I've met both. Now, I've met people who have had reputations, whose reputations preceded them for not such good reasons, for bad reasons. And I've met them and I've talked to them and I thought, you know, that wasn't so bad. I could talk to that person a little bit more. Anybody ever been there? Yeah, you ever been there? All right. And then, I've also met someone with a good reputation and thought to myself, you know, I don't think I really want to spend a whole lot more time with that person. Have you ever been there before? Seen that happen before? Yeah? But I've also met people with bad reputations that I couldn't get away from quickly enough. You know what I mean? And I've also met people with good reputations that I couldn't spend enough time with. I went to Israel with a man who had a good reputation. He's one of the national leaders with the Assemblies of God. And his reputation preceded him. And all I wanted to do was just spend more time with him to find out, you know, his thinking and to find out how he thought about things and to find out, you know, just different aspects of ministry and that kind of thing. I actually met him at JFK before we boarded the plane to go over to Israel. And I thought, wow, what a great guy, you know. And what really impressed me about him is that he was just this person. You know, like he was this real person. Yeah, he leads thousands and thousands and thousands of people. But talking to him, he's just this person. You know, and it reminds me of something that I learned here. It's been quite a while ago, something that I heard quite a while ago. You know, there are people that we truly love, people that we like to be around, and that are used in the supernatural, are just that. They're supernatural. They're just people. And God uses them in the supernatural, but they're just supernatural. They're the real deal. They're authentic. And there are some people that are used in the supernatural, and let's be honest, there are some people that are used in the supernatural spiritual gifts, and they're just weird. You know what I'm saying? You ever met those people before? They're just weird. And it's like they use their spiritual gifts and they get in this weird thing, but then they get out of that and they're just normal. And so it's like when they use their spiritual gifts, they're just weird. You know, it's not super natural. It's weird, even though God uses them in the supernatural. Now, it's those kind of people. It's like, you know, you don't really want to be around them. It's like they're not really grounded in reality. They don't really have a good solid grasp of what's going on. Their faith maybe not really built on facts. You know, faith never really denies the reality of the situation. You know, faith never really denies that. It's like, you know, Paul in the message that he gave earlier, it said, you know, bringing us to the waters. It's not like we can't fake like the waters aren't there. You know, it was a example of what happened to the Israelites when they came up to the Red Sea. You know, the waters were there and were in front of them. The Egyptians were behind them, and they didn't deny the facts that the waters weren't there. They just cried out to God, and God said, "Okay, Moses, put your staff in the water," and he split the Red Sea. You know, and they walked across on dry ground. So faith never denies the reality of the situation. It just realizes that there is a reality that is supernatural, right? Beyond the natural abilities of this world. And Jesus lived this way. He was just this supernatural guy, right? He lived this way. And that's why people liked him, but it's also why people hated him. So don't deny the facts. Don't deny reality when you're being a witness of Jesus. It just makes you look weird, okay? So today we're going to take a look at this very supernatural person who was used supernaturally, and people liked him, but people also, from what we'll see today, people also hated him very much. We're going to take a look, take a brief look at what he was doing and how he was doing it, what Stephen was doing, almost like a little character lesson, but then we're going to do a brief sermon analysis of his too, because Stephen preaches a very powerful sermon in this passage of Scripture. So we're going to take a look at it two ways. We're going to take a look at the person of Stephen, and then we're going to take a look at the sermon of Stephen. And this whole thing is encapsulated in Acts chapter 6, starting with verse 8, and it goes all the way through the end of chapter 7, verse 60. And we're not going to read that all today, okay? But I'm going to just take little scriptures here and there. I'm going to take scriptures here and there throughout that passage and hit the main points with it. So, are you ready? As we look at it today, it's about to get real in here, okay? So if we remember Stephen, he had a good reputation of being full of the Spirit and wisdom. That's what we saw last week. He was made a committee member, basically an overseer in the church. And we see this guy who is not an apostle, a Jew, probably not from Jerusalem, probably didn't see or know Jesus in his life, only learned about him from the church. This is the Stephen that we see here. Look at this, Acts chapter 6. Verses 8 through 10. Now Stephen, a man full of God's grace and power, performed great wonders and signs among the people. Opposition arose, however, from members of the synagogue of the freedmen, as it was called, Jews of Cyrene and Alexandria, as well as the provinces of Cilicia and Asia, who began to argue with Stephen. But they could not stand up against the wisdom the Spirit gave him as he spoke. So here's... Now, you look at that, that's pretty unreal, isn't it? I mean, for this guy, just this powerful man. But here's this man, Stephen, and we see that he had a good reputation for a reason, right? We don't know here why the opposition starts to take place with these Jews. We don't know why. All we know is that opposition arose, right? That's all we see. We don't know why. We're going to get a really good understanding of why here later on, but we don't know why right now. We know, though, that Stephen is well regarded because of the way that Luke is writing about him and the way that Luke continues to write about him. And it says here that he is full of grace and power. Full of grace and power. What an incredible combination to have working in his life. Grace and power. What does that mean? What does that look like? What is grace and power? You know, something that many of us understand about God's grace is that it's God's grace that brings us to salvation, right? For it is grace, you have been saved through faith, right? So we understand that about grace, that it's grace that brings us into salvation. It's God's grace that allows us to be free of our sin, right? Grace doesn't forgive us of our sin. That's something that you need to understand. If there's sin in your life and you need to be forgiven of that sin in your life, you don't need grace. What you need is another term called mercy. Okay? You need God to forgive you, and so you need mercy. You don't need grace if there's a sin issue in your life and you need to be forgiven of that. Grace is what frees you from sin and brings you into salvation. Okay? So we know that grace does that, saving us from spiritual death to spiritual life. And from that point on, God's grace, we live in God's grace. So any maturity that takes place in our life comes as a result of God's grace working in our life. And this whole life in Christ then is a continual act of God's grace. Whether it's being saved from sin or overcoming the temptation to sin or being active in our spiritual gifts or being used in the supernatural or being a witness of Jesus, it's all because of God's grace. That's all a work of God's grace in our lives. And it also means then that what comes out of God's grace working in our lives will come out of our lives. It will be shown to others. Amen. And if we're full of grace, then when people, let me say this. So then as God's grace works in our lives, works in us the character of Jesus, then the character of Jesus will come out of our lives. Okay? And if we're full of grace, like it says that Stephen was, if we're full of grace, what happens if you bump into something and say it's full? Say there's a cup full of water and you happen to bump that cup of water, what happens? It spills out, right? Yeah. And if we're full of grace, then when we bump into people, when people bump into us, what will they receive?
Grace.
Grace, yeah, they'll receive grace. And I don't know about you, but when people bump into me, I want God's grace to spill on them instead of my coffee, right? No, really, instead of the junk that maybe I'm holding on to. Now, you combine that with power. And like Jesus said, we would have the power when the Holy Spirit fills us to be his witness. And this is a combination then for God to do whatever he wants in us to reach out to those that are around us, to touch people, to work, to do whatever he wants in the people of the in the lives of people around us. Which is what he did in the lives of people around Stephen. God did whatever he wanted through Stephen in the lives of those around him. Because Stephen, it says here that Stephen did wonders and signs. The thing is that some people didn't like it. They didn't like it. And wanted to argue with them. And you think, how can that happen? What, you know, here's Stephen working powerfully, you know, God's grace, he's full of God's grace. And so people are receiving God's grace from Stephen. And there's power coming from Stephen, and these great, incredible things are happening, and signs and wonders are happening as a result of him, you know, as God working through his life. And yet some people don't like it. Why wouldn't some people like it? How can that happen? Have you thought about that? Why would opposition arise to that? You see, if God's grace is working, God's grace and power is working in you, and you come across people that are rejecting God's grace, opposition will arise. Does that make sense? But they aren't fighting you, they're fighting God's grace. And as the Holy Spirit comes to move in power, like he was in Stephen's life, then they have to rise up to try to meet that power. And so you have these people who are rejecting God's grace, and as the power of the Holy Spirit is ramping up in Stephen's life, so they feel this need to power up and to rise up in their lives to meet that power and to come against that power, and opposition arises. Does that make sense? And believe me, as God's grace and power rises among us, right? As God's grace and power rises among us, and it will, right? It will continue to rise here, right?
Yes.
Right? Our future is brighter than our past, right? We have better days ahead.
Right.
Greater are the next days, and greater are the days before us than the days behind us, right?
Yeah, right.
God's grace will and power will rise among us. And there may be some in opposition to that. And it may come from outside of us, or it may come from inside of us. Because how many of you know that not everybody that comes to church receives God's grace willingly and freely, and some people that come to church reject God's grace? And so opposition may come from outside, it may come from within. You know, sometimes we can get so mixed up. Have you ever been in that place where you've just been just kind of mixed up? Come on, you know you have.
Yeah.
You've been there. And we can oppose those that we're a part of. And as a result, we oppose God's grace. See, allowing God's grace to work in our lives shows His grace to those around us. And when we do that and we allow God's grace to work in our lives and it to be shown to the people around us, that will help us greatly. But the opposition here that we see in Acts chapter 6, it couldn't stand up against the wisdom the Holy Spirit gave Stephen. The Spirit was reminding Stephen of everything he had learned and how it had applied to his life and the lives of those that he was speaking to. Okay? How many of you recognize that? Jesus says that when the Holy Spirit comes, he will remind you of everything you have learned. Amen. What does that mean we need to do?
Trust.
What can we do? Learn. Right? We need to learn. We need to learn who God is. We need to learn what God wants for us. We need to learn what God says about us. We have to learn about God. We have to learn it so that when a situation comes where that learning can be, where that learning can come into play, the Holy Spirit can remind us and give us the wisdom to put that into practice at that point. In Stephen's case, it was evident not only in his life, but it was evident in his teaching as well. And if you want to be known as this, let me just say this, if you want to be known as this, if you want to be this powerful person, like we see Stephen here, he's this powerful person, you know, God is using him, and he's just has learned a great amount, and he's powerful. If you want to be this powerful person, whether it's spiritually powerful or not, you have to learn. You have to be a learner. You have to learn and learn and learn and learn. Which, in other words, in order to learn, what do you have to do?
Study.
Study. And what's usually involved in studying?
Reading.
You have to read. Readers, learners, and leaders are readers. Now, I will say this. This is something that I am really struggling with. I'm really having a tough time just digging in and taking the time to read, okay? But it's something that something that I started when I first got here, and I was reading pretty regularly, and all of a sudden I just kind of got out of habit. And so for a while I haven't been reading as much as I would like to. I'm struggling, so I want to challenge you today, and I'm challenging myself a little bit. Let's do this together, okay? You want to be a powerful person? You want to be somebody that has, you know, that has a lot of the knowledge, and you can, and you've learned it, and you can apply it. So you just kind of, you know, you walk around and you're this powerful person. Anybody want to take that challenge with me, where you'll say, "Yeah, I'm gonna read, and I'm gonna learn, And I'm going to learn about a lot of different stuff, not just about the Bible, about who God is, but I'm going to learn about a lot of different things. Would any of you be willing to take that challenge with me? That say, yeah, I'm going to be a learner. All right, good. Okay, I'm going to hold you to it, okay? I know everybody that raised their hand. And I'm going to... but really, take the challenge. Be a learner. Be this powerful person. But really, find out and read the Bible and study the Bible and find out who God is. Now, let me ask you this. Last week, I put a challenge out there for you. And I said, who will pray and who will read their Bible every day? Because you want to, you want the Holy Spirit to move and be active in your life. And a lot of people raised their hands and said, yeah, I'll do that. Can I ask you this? Did anybody start reading their Bible this week as a result of that commitment? Did you? Okay, good. I've got something for you. I'll get it for you later, okay? That's really cool. Thank you for sharing. Anybody else do that this week? Yeah, cool. Awesome. Thanks. For you too. All right? Okay? It is so powerful when we just start putting in practice the things that God wants us to put into practice. Now, if that's not enough, these guys, they stir up trouble for Stephen, and they become a different kind of witnesses. Instead of witnesses for Jesus, they become a different kind of witnesses. The Bible says that they become false witnesses. Okay? And the accusations that are that Stephen was teaching against the holy place, so against the temple, and maybe even against Jerusalem, and against the customs of worship in the temple. So Stephen is going to address this thought of a holy place and the customs of worship. Now, let me say this. If you want to take on those two things against the Sanhedrin in first century Israel, you just go right ahead and you have your fun little time with that. Because it will not go well with you. Because the Sanhedrin, remember from what we learned, the Sanhedrin, they were in control and they liked being in control. And if somebody came along and they upset their apple cart and they decided, hey, we're going to do a little investigation here, and if at any point they could get you to say the wrong thing, they could punish you to death. And they would, because they liked it. They liked their control. And they didn't want anybody to upset that control. So if you wanted to do that at that time, I would just say, hey, you just go right ahead. But here Stephen and the Sanhedrin brings him in because people are bringing these accusations to the Sanhedrin against him. And at that point, he doesn't have a choice on whether to talk or not. So he just relies on Jesus and says, okay, here it is. You want to know about this? This is what it is. And he starts preaching and basically tells the entire history of Israel through his teaching up to the time of Solomon who built the temple. And what you're going to see here is that Stephen spoke. He spoke under the power of the Holy Spirit, and he preaches an incredible sermon, much better than the one that I'm preaching today. And he takes on this thought of this holy place, and he takes on the issue of the land, first of all, to start. Because the Jews, they thought that they had some special privilege because of the land that they lived in, and especially the Sanhedrin. They had power over that area. They had control over that area. And they thought they had some special privilege because of this land that they lived on. And it was the land that God gave them. And yeah, they are the chosen people of God. But the big problem with this thinking is they thought that because they were living in the land, they were good. And if they were good, then they didn't need a savior. And here's the deal. At this time in the book of Acts, sure, you know, there were a lot of Jews that were living in Israel. Most of the Jews were living in Israel. But some had been dispersed to different parts of the Roman Empire because the Romans had control of Israel. And yet, here's the Sanhedrin still thinking, hey, we live in this land. We're people of spiritual privilege. We're good. We don't need a savior because we still live in this land. Stephen's about to tell them some things. And he starts telling them, and he starts with Abraham, the beginning of the Hebrew faith. He starts there. Look at this, Acts chapter 7, verse 2. The God of glory appeared to our father Abraham while he was still in Mesopotamia before he lived in Haran. God appeared to him where? Not in Israel. In Mesopotamia. Where's that? You know? But that's where God first appeared to Abraham. God chose Abraham first, not in Israel. God showed himself and was with Abraham in Mesopotamia. And Stephen goes on to say about Abraham, look at this, verse 5, Acts chapter 7, verse 5. He gave him no inheritance here. He's talking about in the land they were living at that moment, Israel. Not even enough to set his foot on. But God promised him that he and his descendants after him would possess the land, even though at that time Abraham had no child. And basically Stephen's point is that God blessed Abraham, even though Abraham never lived in the land that we live in. And none of the people sitting there were going to argue that point, that God didn't bless Abraham, because God did bless Abraham. And they weren't going to say that because he was the father of their faith. He was the father of who they were. He was the father of the Hebrew people. The Jews still referred to God as the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. It was God that chose Abraham, and their whole existence started with them. So they're not going to argue with Stephen on that. But yet Stephen makes his point. God blessed Abraham even while he wasn't in Israel. But Stephen says, hey, you know, let's not stop with Abraham. Let's go on to Moses, the guy who gave us our identity, right? Moses, and this is what it says, chapter 7, verses 20 through 22. At that time, Moses was born, and he was no ordinary child. For 3 months, he was cared for by his family. And when he was placed outside, Pharaoh's daughter took him in and brought him up as her own son. Moses was educated in all the wisdom of the Egyptians and was powerful in speech and action. Moses was born and raised where?
Egypt.
In Egypt, not in Israel, right? He became the man that God wanted him to be in where?
The wilderness.
In the wilderness, in Midian, from which where God spoke to him from the burning bush. Moses had this burning bush experience where God met him face to face in the burning bush. And where was that? Right outside of Midian, near Mount Sinai. God called that place where he and Moses met holy ground. A place definitely not in Israel. Look at this, verse 30 and 33. After 40 years had passed, an angel appeared to Moses in the flames of a burning bush in the desert near Mount Sinai. And then skip over to verse 33. Then the Lord said to him, take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground, not Israel. Stephen also talks to them about Mount Sinai, where the law was given to Moses from God. Where was the law given? Mount Sinai, not in Israel, right? I mean, the customs Moses gave, and he tells them that, hey, you know, our ancestors, they rejected Moses at that place and crafted an idol into worship in that place. Then Stephen says that our ancestors, they carried a tabernacle, a place where God dwelt with them all throughout the wilderness, not in Israel. And they were wandering the desert there for 40 years. They even had that tabernacle, that not permanent place in Israel, for a long time until the king, the person that the Jews looked to as the king, David, came along. But even David wasn't allowed to build a tabernacle or to build a permanent structure for God, a place for God to dwell. Only his son Solomon could do that. And then Stephen even goes on from there, and he references the prophet, the great prophet. You know, the Jews, they looked at Isaiah as the prophet. You know, I mean, he was like the prophet above all the other prophets. He was the great prophet. He was the one that prophesied very specifically about a Messiah. And so they loved quoting Isaiah. They loved looking at Isaiah and all the prophecy that Isaiah brought. And Stephen uses Isaiah in this, in Acts chapter 7, verses 49 through 50. And he says this, "Heaven is my throne, and the earth is my footstool. What kind of house will you build for me? Says the Lord. Or where will my resting place be? Has not my hand made all these things?" In other words, if the heavens is his throne and the earth is his footstool, how could we build a structure enough for God, that God can dwell in? You see, what Stephen has done here is basically he has killed some sacred cows, hasn't he? He's killed some sacred cows. He has shown them that it isn't about a place of worship, it's about living for God. It isn't about a land that you live in, it's that God can be experienced wherever you are. You know, and I was thinking about this, and I thought, well, you know, what kind of sacred cows do we have built up in our lives? What kind of sacred cows do I have built up in my life? You know, and I thought about, well, what are sacred cows? You know, what are, if Stephen is talking about these things, you know, like this, what are these things doing? These objects of worship, basically, or they're not really objects of worship, but places to worship, you know what I'm saying? Where people think they have spiritual privilege because they have them or possess them or own them or go there. What are some things that, you know, I have? Or what are some things that we kind of have? And, you know, I thought about it, and I thought that if there are things that keep us or keep others from coming to God freely, or make us think that we have some spiritual privilege, that might be what you could consider a sacred cow. You know, anytime that we think that we have God because of something that we have or we own, or a place that we go or who we are, that might be something that God is wanting us to give up. That might be what you could consider a sacred cow. And then he says this. Look at this, verse 51. Verses 51 through 53. Stephen says, "You stiff-necked people, your hearts and ears are still uncircumcised. You are just like your ancestors. You always resist the Holy Spirit. Was there ever a prophet your ancestors did not persecute? They even killed those who predicted the coming of the righteous one. And now you have betrayed and murdered him. You have received the law that was given through angels, but have not obeyed it." Now, we look at these words and they look pretty harsh, don't they? But these are words that God spoke against the Israelites all throughout history. "You stiff-necked people." And let me tell you, if there are stiff-necked Jews, they're probably stiff-necked Norwegians and stiff-necked Germans and stiff-necked whatever you might happen to be in this place. Scandinavians, Europeans, whatever it might be. You know, I wonder sometimes if we're a little stiff-necked. I know I am. I know I am. We hear what we want to hear. We only accept the things that we've decided we're going to accept. And if someone comes along and says something different, we do something to try to make them be quiet. You know, I've seen it a lot of times. I've seen it where somebody is bringing something that I've never heard before, but I already have my mind made up on what God does do and what God doesn't do. And I'm not going to accept or listen to anything outside of that. When the reality is what can God do? Somebody help me out. What can God do? He can do anything he wants to do, can't he? And instead of doing what God wants, I end up being disobedient, not obeying the law. And then you know what it's easy to start doing? Because we're not obeying the law, it's easy to start throwing rocks, isn't it? You ever been in that place? God can't do that. Where's my rock? You've been there. How many of you have been there? You've been there. Thank you. Now let me tell you about stoning, because that's what they do to Stephen here a little bit. Okay? They Stephen says this phrase, they get mad, they rush him out of the city, and they stone him. Does anybody know what stoning is? What stoning looked like? Anybody know what that looks like? What does it look like? Anybody know? How does stoning start? When somebody is stoned, how does it start? Well, actually, it even starts before that. What they do is they take you to an embankment of some kind, or a cliff, or a building, and somebody is standing behind the person that's about to get stoned, and they push on the top of their body, and they push them on the top of their body, so all that force from the top of their body then starts swinging around, and they fall head first, okay? And they fall head first down an embankment or off a building or off a cliff or whatever it is. And this is all, you can find this all in the Hebrew Mishnah. The Mishnah tells the Hebrews on how to do certain things, and you can find it. And so they do that so that they fall head first. And if that doesn't kill them, then what they do is they take a large rock and they throw it down on them on their chest. Okay? That's the next step. If that doesn't kill them, then they all start picking up rocks. All the people standing around, and they start hurling them at the person until that person dies. And I look at this, and that's exactly what Stephen does. Now, you go back a little bit earlier in Acts chapter 6, at the end of Acts chapter 6, and it says, here's Stephen standing before the Sanhedrin, and his face is like a face of an angel. So here's this man, this powerful man, and God's power is on him. And they like looking at him, but a few minutes later, they are so willing to just utterly destroy him. Later on, it says that his face was glowing. What I love about Stephen, though, is that he so thoroughly wanted to be like Jesus, that he even died like Jesus. Look at this, verses 59 and 60, Acts 7, verses 59 and 60. While they were stoning him, Stephen prayed, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Does that, for those of you that know the story of Jesus dying on the cross, does that sound familiar? With your hands I commit my spirit. And then he fell on his knees and cried out, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. And when he had said this, he fell asleep. Stephen was consumed with being like Jesus. All he wanted to do was be like Jesus. Jesus died because he was willing to speak out against the traditions of the Sanhedrin, and they didn't like it. Stephen died because he spoke out against the traditions of the Sanhedrin and was about to upset their power. And they didn't like him. But he brought home a powerful point, and he said that God resides everywhere. He is with you wherever you go, no matter who you are, no matter where you're at. It doesn't matter. His presence does not reside in places built with human hands. His presence resides in you, and it resides in me if you're a Christian. And we can have God's presence with us wherever we go, no matter what we're doing. And so, and I think the point is that Stephen is just saying, hey, just invite people into the conversation. Invite people into God's presence. It's with you. Just invite people into it to experience it for themselves. Because it doesn't matter where you are. The heavens are God's throne, and the earth is his footstool. He surrounds it all. He's God. Just invite people along to experience it with you. Is the point that Stephen makes. And they didn't like that. They didn't want anything to do with that. Now, what we're going to see from here on out is that the church spreads miraculously through this. It's not what they wanted. It's not what the church necessarily wanted. But from here, the church just spreads like fire all throughout the Middle Eastern part of the world, Europe, and down through North Africa and all places from here as a result of what starts to happen here in this place that we're looking at in Acts chapter 7. And it's pretty amazing. So let me tell you how things are going to go here for the next little while. Next week is the week after Thanksgiving. Next week I'm going to start talking about Christmas. Okay? Christmas. Yeah, I'm going to start talking about Christmas. How many of you love Christmas? Or you like Christmas at least? Or maybe you have a tolerance for Christmas. I don't know. You know, I love Christmas. And I love the themes of Christmas. I like the Christmas songs. I like some of the Christmas hymns that we sing. And I just like a lot about Christmas. I love Christmas. It's a joyous thing. It's a time of not just joy, but it's a time of anticipation of not only, the Jews were looking for the Savior to come. We're looking for the Savior to come again, right? A second time. And so it's a time of expectation and anticipation. And so I'm excited about that. So from here on out, from now until Christmas, I'm going to start talking about Christmas. And then after Christmas, then we'll dive back into Acts and finish up the first 10 chapters. Yeah, we'll finish it up there. We're not all that far away, but we'll dive back into it, get back into it after the first of the year, okay? So that's how things are going to go. Today is a huge day. Today is a big, big day. Today is the day that we can literally provide thousands and thousands of meals for people throughout the world. And so we're going to take a look at that. Clayton's going to show a video here in a second. Let me explain to you how this is going to happen. So we are going to take an offering here in a minute, and I want to encourage you to give. If you haven't made a commitment, if you haven't been saving up your money maybe to give in this offering like we have, we've decided we're going to give one day's wage, and so we've calculated that out, and we know what that looks like for us. But if you haven't, I just want to encourage you to give generously in this offering we're about to take. We're going to take the offering. The ushers are going to go back and count it real quick. We're going to get a total for you here very quickly so that we can see before we leave today how much we have provided for. Okay? Does that sound good?
Yes.
No? Yes? Okay, that's what we're going to do.
See.
All right, Clayton, show us the video.
Every day, families gather together to eat. For most, food is plentiful and the source is secure.